Know that God is nigh. Don't try to fight the battle yourself, but stand still and look up. God is going to show up.
God is going to show up.
He's standing right by.
He is standing by.
We want to say that one more time for somebody who may be discouraged. Don't be discouraged. Joy is on the way. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Know that God is now.
Stand still. Stand still and look up.
Knowing that God is going to show up.
Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
For those of you who may not know it, there's healing.
Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Lord, send it for this one thing we love. There's a bomb in Gilead. Hallelujah.
I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us
we want to tell you one more time,
exalt his name together.
For your sorrow.
For
I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. I looked unto him and were light, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, saved him out of all his troubles. Angel of the Lord encampeth around about him that feared him and delivered him. Oh, taste and see.
Listen, he was wounded.
That the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Who fear the Lord, these saints. For there is no want for them that fear him.
I'm healed right now. I'm healed for your heartache.
You may be seated. My brothers and sisters, we have come for the homegoing services for Mr. Marcus H. Johnson. And I believe that no matter what we go through in this walk of life, that God is still worthy to be praised. No matter how difficult life becomes, God is still worthy to be praised. And since God is worthy to be praised at any time, I think right now is a good time to give the Lord some praise. Join with me, put your hands together, and give God some praise, for he is worthy of all of our praise. Are there any saints in this house that believe that God is worthy to be praised? The program has been outlined by the family, and we have an opening hymn. I'm not certain who's supposed to sing it. Amen. Do we have? If not, amen. Reverend Martin is here. If you would come now and give us an opening. Let me do this. Reverend Martin will give us the opening hymn. Scripture reading will be by Pastor Henry Clare. I will come back with the prayer of comfort. A solo by Reverend Martin once again. And then I will come back just before the remarks. Let's follow the program in that manner. Amen.
Bree family, to you all of God's children, we came to celebrate a life and come to mourn. We came to understand that God is still in charge. Amen. God is still in charge. We're going to try this song. There is a land that is far than day, and to see it, seen it afar, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, yeah, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Oh, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Oh, there is a land that is far and day. Mm-hmm. can you see it afar? Oh, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Yeah, oh, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Can you help me clap? Oh, when the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that shore, that beautiful shore. Hey, in that sweet by and by, oh, sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Said again, in there, sweet by and by, my Lord, sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. One more time, help me sing it. Oh, in the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore, the beautiful shore.
Hallelujah to Jesus. I do offer my condolences to the family. His dad and I have been friends for a very, 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 very long time. This was a sudden hit when I heard it, but God is in control. I'm going to read for your hearing, beginning at chapter 139. Lord, you hem me in and behind, before me. You laid your hands upon me, God. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths of hell, there you are. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me and your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become bright even around me, then even the darkness shall not be dark to you. The night shall shine like the noonday sun. For darkness is always as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, sir, because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that quite well. And my frame was not hidden from you when I was made in my mother's womb. You wove me together in the depths thereof. And every day of my life was appointed and written in your book before I began to live any one of them. For the second scripture, I'd like to read from the book of Matthew. It says, and for his correct, Corinthians 1:15 describes the body, but it goes on to tell you in 1 Corinthians, listen, I'll tell you a mystery. You'll not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the right sound of the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will rise first, unbearable, and we will be changed all in a moment, in that same twinkling of an eye. For the perishable shall clothe themselves with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. And the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. Then this saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where is your strength, O death? Where is your victory, and where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, my brothers and my sisters, stand firm and let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the works of the Lord, because we know that your labor is not in vain, and you will see each other once again. I read the scriptures of God for those who are the household of faith. God bless you.
Let us pray. Gracious Lord, our God and our Father. Father, we humbly come in your presence right now. Bow down heads and broken hearts. For death has stepped in and snatched out a loved one. And Father, in times like these, there's nowhere else we can turn. So we come now to honor you and give your name the glory. We come now to praise you. And while we are praising you, we need to ask that you wrap your arms around this family. Put your arms around this mother whose heart has got to be torn up for the loss of a child. The rest of the family, Lord, we ask that you gird them up right now in the hollow parts of your hand. They need you. The waiting congregation, Father, whose hearts are heavy this afternoon, help them to get through this. Father, we praise your name because we know nothing else to do in times like these. Understanding the cliche words that says when praises go up, blessings come down, we need a blessing in this house. We know not where else to turn. We know not what else to do. But Lord, you promised that you'd be our refuge. You promised that we could run to you. You promised that you would be there always. So Father, now we ask that you would bless these services to be what you would have them to be. Bless every portion of this. And then, Lord, bless everyone under the sound of my voice. And we'll be careful to give your name the praise. In the blessed name of Jesus, we pray now. Amen. Brother Reverend Martin, if you would come now and give us another song. Now I would ask that you would join us in the pulpit. I talked to him. He didn't want to come up. Not unless you change your mind.
I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days. Some sleepless nights, but when I look around and I think things over, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. And I won't Sometimes the clouds hang low.
That's right.
I can hardly see the road.
Yes.
I ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? But he knows what's best for me. Although my weary eyes, they can't see. So I'll say thank you, Lord, and I won't complain. God has been so good to me. He's been good to me more than this old world or you could ever be. He's been so good to me. He tears away, turned my midnight sin today. So I'll say thank you, Lord, and I won't complain. He dried every one of my tears away, turned my midnights into days. So I'll say thank you, Lord. In spite of everything that I'm going through, I'll say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, and I won't complain.
Next line item that we have that the family has outlined, they have asked remarks from a family member, Miss Ariel Thomas. And so we would ask that family member would come now. Is Mr. Calvin Johnson here? Amen. Following the remarks, Mr. Calvin Johnson will come with a solo. Just in case Elder James Davis is not here. Is he here yet? Just in case he is not here. God always have a ram in the bush. Amen. One thing we'll talk about that more just in case he comes. Remarks and then solo.
Ladies and gentlemen, we gather here today to remember and celebrate the life of a truly unique individual. Marcus had an incredible zest for life. He celebrated every moment with a spirit that inspired those around him. whether it was sharing a laugh over a drink or finding humor in the most unexpected places, he had a way of making every day brighter. His love for humor and laughter was just one aspect of his personality. He also had an uncanny ability to connect with people on a deep and genuine level. He made friendships that last a lifetime and touched the hearts of many. He also was a love coach. He put my sister and his best friend together, and they've been together for 20 years now, so he's a love coach. At the age of 41, Marcus may have left this world far too soon, but he leaves behind a legacy of living life to the fullest and cherishing the moments we have. You know, in one of his last videos, his tagline was members only, which reminds us that life is a journey and the only membership requirement is to embrace it with an open arm. Members only, which in its simplicity encapsulated his spirit and approach to life. Marcus was someone who lived life by his own rules, unapologetically, and with a sense of humor that was contagious. You know, as we say our goodbyes today, let's remember Marcus for the laughter he brought into our lives, the camaraderie he shared, and the lesson he taught us about living life authentically. He may no longer be here with us in person, but his memory will forever be a part of all of our lives. Rest in peace, dear friend, brother, son, and just a great person. He will always be cherished member of our hearts. Love 215, the family.
But as it
a poem for Marcus. There was a boy named Marcus. He was the sharpest. He liked his dogs. He had to land and play with logs. He had a small house, but he never had a mouse. Marcus lived happy. His hair was never nappy. Marcus was the best. I never saw him wear a vest. I never called Marcus a fool, but I know he was cool. Marcus was love. When I saw him, I always stopped. I miss Marcus, you too, but just know he's always above. Marcus, forever in our hearts, always.
You know, this is Marcus' cousin, and she came up with that poem by herself. She said, could she read it? So I told her, when I do the solo, you can come up and do it. And I'm not a singer, but God is the joy, he's the strength of my life. He moves all pain, injury, and strife. He promised ever, never leave me. Ever, ever, will I ever turn back? God is, whoa, God is, God is my all, and God is the joy, he's the strength of my life. He moves all the pain and the injury and strife. He promised to keep me, never to leave me. Never ever will I ever turn back. God is, whoa, God is, God is my all and all. Thank you.
Last call for Elder James Davis. Amen. Bible says, be ye ever so ready. If you're called to be a preacher, whenever you're pressed into action to preach, you should be ready to preach. There's a word from the Lord, and it's found in Job, the 14th chapter. Verse 1 says, man that is born of a woman is of a few days, and they are full of trouble. If I was to try to put a text, a word, a title to this little talk I'm going to have this afternoon, it would be, Pat, accept what God allows. Accept what God allows. Let us pray, gracious Father, our Lord and our God. It is now preaching time. And I'm aware that I can't preach until the preacher shows up. So, Father, I need you to hide me in your bosom and to manifest yourself through me. Speak, Lord. These thy children, listen. They did not come to hear from me, but they came to hear a word from above. So use me, Lord, until you use me up. And we'll be careful to give your name the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Accept what God allows. My brothers and sisters, as we look at this text, we find this man named Job going through probably argumentatively the hardest thing that any parent has to go through, and that is the loss of a child. You see, one day God and Satan was having a conversation. And God said to Satan, have you tried my servant Job? He's a perfect and upright man. Satan with his wise self says, God, Job don't serve you so for nothing. But if you let me take the hedge out from around him, I promise you I'll make him curse you to your face. God allows, let me say that again, God allows Satan to attack Job. Satan took all of his children, and not only did he take all of his sons, but he took all of his daughters too. I can imagine, Sister Pat, that your heart must be broken. As a parent, we are never prepared for our child to leave here before we do. Job declares that a man born of a woman is of a few days and they're full of trouble. Can I tell you who's going to have trouble in this room? Can I tell you who bad things are going to happen to in this place right here? And the answer is every one of us who are born of a woman. In other words, everyone who is born, rich, poor, black, or white, you're going to have some bad things happen in your life. So the first thing I see here is that we must accept what God allows first and foremost, because there's nothing we can do about it. Amen, somebody. We can't stop disasters. We can't stop mass shootings. We can't stop death. You see, this world has been corrupt by sin. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, the Bible tells us that one of the devastating results of sin was that the earth was cursed. In the Garden of Eden, everything was perfect. There was no disease, no tragedy, no pain. It was sin that gave birth to sickness, disease, pain, turmoil, and even death. Sin has tainted the entire world and everything and everyone in the world. David said something like this in Psalm 51:5, I was born in sin. and shaped in my iniquity. And here's our problem, saints of God and folk in this waiting congregation. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. From the pulpit all the way to the back door, all of us. Amen, somebody. Not only will you have bad things happen to you because of sin, but you're going to only live just a few days. Some are going to live the right old age, get to be up in the numbers. Some are going to live just to 42, like our dear brother. Some are going to die sooner. Job says in verse 2, he cometh forth like a flower, and is cut down, and fleeth also as a shadow, and continueth not. Job, in other words, say, I accept what God has allowed. Mm-hmm. Let me tell y'all something. Accepting what God allows does not make the pain any less. Mm-hmm. Accepting what God allows does not make the pain go away. Does not make the pain stop. No, your heart is still going to be broken. The pain will still be severe. Matter of fact, the pain will even get worse when you ask the question, why? Why did this have to happen? Why did this have to take place? And it gets even worse when you can't get no answer. Amen, somebody. Why, Lord, did you let this happen? It is a question that we all have asked at some point in time. And the old folk used to say, you don't question God. I say you don't blame God. Because some questions you can't ask nobody but God. Amen, somebody. Man, let me talk a little bit about Job, and I'm almost done. Job was a wealthy man. And according to Job 1:3, his substance was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she asses. And he was had a very great household. So this man, according to the Bible, was the greatest man in the East. Job seems to accept what God allows because Job declared, naked I came into the world, and naked I will leave. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The message Job gives us here cuts deep, especially with some Christian teachings. That says that God's main concern is to make us happy, healthy, and wealthy. Let me tell you something. God's main concern is not to make you happy, but to make you holy. This reality can be quite disturbing for many people. You see, we tend to serve God for what we can get out of God. Nothing more than a shrewd business transaction for some folk. If God blesses me with favor, I'll serve him. But if he doesn't, I won't. For the most part, we are nothing more than religious consumers looking for the best return of our investment. If God makes the cut, then I'll give him a shot. But when bad things happen and suffering comes, we reject God. Job says in Job 2:9, shall we accept the good things of God and not the trouble? Job portrays it's hard to enjoy God sometimes. You must still trust in him. Job says in 13 and 15, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. My brothers and sisters, I didn't know the brother real well, Marcus, at all. But I came by here to tell you that I know my God. And it's his desire that no man is lost. And if he call on the name of the Lord, my Bible tells me that he shall be saved. Now, when we look at that word saved in that scripture, it is the same word that's saved, same Greek word that of saved that we find in Romans 10 and 9. And in Romans 10 and 9, we find a plan of salvation. That if thou will confess the Lord Jesus and to believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shall be saved. Amen, somebody. I'm glad, y'all, that man does not have a heaven or hell to put nobody in. I'm glad. Because some of us wouldn't make it. Amen. Some of us, you might owe somebody some money. And you die in time to go to heaven or hell. They say, he owed me some money. He can't go in. Maybe you said something about somebody and they remember it. They won't let it go. You die, it's time for you to go to heaven. So, nah, they hurt my feelings. And they can't go in. No, you don't have a heaven. Man does not have heaven or hell to put anybody in. And you can't go by their lifestyle. Can I give you a case in point? Y'all remember the thief on the cross? He hadn't lived for anybody. He hadn't lived there. He didn't live a righteous life. He didn't live. He was always doing something. He had no business, but he hung on the cross and he accepted Jesus as his Savior on the cross. When he accepted Jesus as his Savior, Jesus said, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. And if I believe that if Jesus would stop dying long enough to save him, then he's able to save us or save anybody. We just called on the name of the Lord. Well, I'm done. But the last reason that you can accept what God allows, because he's going to always be with us. He promised that I'll be with you even till the end of the world. He promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. So I just believe that when the burdens get heavy and you're trying to accept what the Lord allows, just know that he's standing right there with you. Just know that he won't let you fall. And if I can just keep my hand in his unchanging hand, he's gonna make everything right after a while. Somebody say he may not come when you call him, but he's always on time. I came by here to ask the question, does anybody know that you serve an on-time God? Won't he show up just in the nick of time and work that thing out for you? He's going to work this out. I know your heart is broken, but hold on to the Lord, and he will. Somebody know he will. He will fix this thing for you. He will mend the broken heart. He promised that he would never leave us. No, forsake us. We can accept what God allows because he's walking right there with us. Amen. Amen. I am free. Praise the Lord, I'm free. No longer bound. No more chains holding me. My soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. I am free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. No longer bound, no more chains holding me, my soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free. Let me do this verse. When in the valley, oh, one day to pray, my soul got so happy, till I stayed there all day, my soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free. Last verse. When in the valley, oh, one day to pray, my soul got so happy, till I stayed there all day, my soul is resting. Ain't that a blessing? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free.